Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome founder and president of Business Forward, Jim Doyle.
There we go. Thank you all very much for coming. It's great to be here to unveil a world's first. But the great thing about this is you don't need to come all the way to Salt Lake City and tour a remarkable facility like this for the people in this room to understand what can happen when a big innovative company like eBay Inc. partners with state and local governments to tackle a big problem. In clean energy, and just like in most other policy issues, things get done when government listens to business and when business steps up to help government get things done. The challenge, even for companies like yours and business leaders like you, is it's really hard to have an impact on your own. Your company may be the biggest employer in your hometown, but that doesn't mean you know how to help pass a bill. You may be the leading expert on a regulation that could kill your business, but that doesn't mean you know which agency to call. You may be on a first-name basis with your senator, but that doesn't mean you like to lobby her. The challenge is that everyone in this room has something to contribute, but you all have businesses to run. You want the time you spend talking about energy policy to be as meaningful and as efficient as possible. And that's why Business Forward has partnered with eBay and a bunch of other companies to hold briefings like this all around the country. Every day we're somewhere. We've worked with tens of thousands of business leaders. Today it's clean energy, sometimes it's exports, sometimes it's cybersecurity, sometimes it's immigration reform. Our job is to help tens of thousands of business leaders get together in rooms like this and work with policymakers and help come up with ways to create more jobs and accelerate our economic recovery. Our job is really about hard work and scale. We take notes, so make sure that every one of your questions gets answered, every one of your recommendations is considered completely. When you leave a briefing like this, we combine your recommendations with the recommendations we've received in other rooms like this from other industries or in other cities. And that's why we're so excited to be here today, because we've got 300 senior executives from some of the most innovative companies on the planet. We've got policymakers from the university, Congress, and from the governor's office and the state legislature. We've got thought leaders from Stanford and the University of Illinois. We've got all sorts of people watching online. You very rarely get an opportunity to spread the word as well and as effectively as we have it today. So that's why we're excited you're here, because we're going to be talking a lot in the next few minutes about the science, the politics, the policy, the economics behind what happened here in Salt Lake City today. But the real big question is, what's next? And that's why you're here. We very much look forward to hearing what you have to say. But of course, before you can build on a success, you have to understand what's behind it. And so we're going to be doing a few things today. The first is we're going to show you a short video which captures some of the massive economic changes that are going on that are driving the need for investments like the one we're in today. So let's take a look. Now I'd like to introduce eBay Inc.'s Chief Technology and Senior Vice President of Global Technology, Mark Karges. Mark is responsible for eBay's platform strategy and for the web software development and site operations for eBay.com. There's no one at the company who understands more about the importance of what's going on here today and the effort that went into it than Mark. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks so much, Jim.
Thanks, Jim. And welcome, everyone, and thank you so much for coming. This is a very, very exciting day, and it's great to see you all on the webcast and see everyone in the room here that shortly after this day will not be filled with chairs and people, but will be filled with racks and computers and running our business in global commerce to help connect everyone, as we've just seen in the video. Before we get started, I want to thank some of our partners that are here and a few people. First, our technology partners, Bloom Energy, Dell, HP, and Ormat, who have all, and many, many others, who have all worked for so long to help us get to this point. I've been here throughout the journey, watching us bring this to life with our partners, and it's extremely impressive. And as Jim says, while you may have a vision in your head for how to do this, you really have to connect with lots of different partners, both in our in technology and outside of technology and local government to make this happen. So really, really exciting. And then, of course, I'd like to thank my team, led by Sri Shivananda and Dean Nelson, and all of their supporters who are here and their teammates. Thank you very much. Your work has certainly paid off, and it's fascinating to see what true out-of-the-box thinking can yield. And I've watched Dean do this now for about 3 or 4 years at eBay, and it's been a real pleasure. So as you know, today we're standing in one of the world's most state-of-the-art data centers of its kind, best-in-class technology infrastructure deployed, and it was brought to life really with a focus and drive for how to rethink and redesign data center technology. I mean, as you know, as an internet company, you know, this is sort of all we have. You know, the physical assets we have are the buildings that our people are in, and then the buildings that our computers and networks are in. And so we really, really rely on this infrastructure and the innovations in this infrastructure so we can continue to grow and power more commerce. So let me start with a little history so you know how we got here today. And it started a few years ago with a partnership we did with Bloom Energy, actually at one of the buildings that house our people, at our North Campus where PayPal is. And in the summer of 2009, we built a 500 kilowatt fuel cell to help one of our buildings, to power one of our buildings. And since then, it has continuously provided power, and it's saving us about 15%. Or it's providing us about 15% of the total power of that site and saving us hundreds of thousands of dollars in electricity each year. And that has been a big success for us. And what that did is that got us thinking about, you know, how could we do more? Dean immediately thought, well, how can we do more, you know, at our data centers? And, you know, we know there are many companies who have used this type of power as backup or something not quite in the main, but Dean wanted to go right for how do we do this in the main, and Bloom was very, very eager to work with us on that. And so we really rethought the traditional data center design, and we looked at how we could use this as the primary energy source for this data center. And there was other things that had to be done on the state and local level, which you'll hear more about. And then in about 1 year ago, I was here with my team where we broke ground. Literally, I think you may have seen, and you'll see in one of the videos, where we broke ground here not that long ago to not only build out the centers here for the new containers, and there's a whole other story about the density we're providing that you'll hear about today, but also to be powered by the Bloom cells you saw outside when you walked in. And so what we're doing is we've provided the world's first data center that's primarily powered by these energy cells with the traditional grid that you can also see outside as the backup. Of course, others have done the reverse. We're the first who have done it this way. And it's really proving to be a great model. And we've got it up and running today. And you'll all be able to see this throughout the day. So this not only makes good business sense for us, but of course it makes great environmental sense, which is very, very important. And our speakers today, including Peter Gross from Bloom and others who are here and in the audience, will talk more about this in some panels and the journey that we've been on to get here to share with everyone how we've done this. You saw how the video highlighted, as consumers and as the world is being more and more connected, it's very, very important that it's transforming every single industry and how they bring their services online. And clearly this is something in our business with commerce and with payments and how we enable commerce. It's extremely, extremely important. So let me talk a little bit just about our business so you can get a sense of what that's grounded in. So, the data centers, of course, are a critical part of how we support the growth in our business. And as more people come online and as more people are comfortable shopping and paying online, it's very important that our infrastructure can support that growth. And so in our marketplaces, our eBay.com business, consumers come to us because they want fun, compelling, easy experiences to find the world's global inventory and then get it to them very seamlessly and quickly and be able to pay for it very easily. And so just at the end of the first half of this year, we had over 120 million consumers come to our different sites, searching over 400 million items for sale from over 25 million sellers who are providing that on a global basis, and more recently providing it locally as we've been piloting things like our eBay Now and partnerships with local retailers in order to get that inventory. And it's basically all transacted, in these rooms and in the rooms next to us. Which is really fascinating. And we're continuing to grow those numbers, whether it's the number of people coming or whether it's the number of items for sale, or the number of sellers, the number of types of things you can buy, that's all growing. PayPal as well has been growing, transacting lots of business. We had about 132 million active customers serving them and the millions of merchants through the first half of this year as well. Sending money to each other, sending money to merchants, basically paying and being paid in new and unique ways. And that business continues to thrive as well. And then our eBay Enterprise business, where we have top retailers and brands. At the end of last year, we had over 1,000 retailers and brands doing over 45 million orders, again, inside of these data centers that are here as well. So, when you put that all together, and we our CFO summed this up very nicely at our Financial Analyst Day we had in March of this year, where we talk about the total volume that we enable, the total commerce volume we enable of all those commerce and payment volumes that I just mentioned. And as of last year, we were doing about $175 billion in total enabled commerce volume, with a stated goal by 2015 to do $300 billion in enabled commerce volume, which is quite a lot of growth, but as you saw in the video, entirely plausible and something we have to make sure we're able to support. And so Dean and his team need to stay about four steps ahead of the business in order to make sure that infrastructure is in place and can support that growth and support it in very new and innovative ways, which is very exciting to see. And so in order to reach our long-term as well as our short-term growth potential, of course, we need to have a high-performing technical infrastructure that can really help turn us and enable more of that commerce globally. And we have to be able to do this in a way that gives us the operational efficiencies we need, but also has us pushing the envelope. So we're challenging state-of-the-art and then pushing that forward and creating new so that we can do cleaner and greener commerce. What's fascinating about what's culminated here is it was developed on a global scale, which is great to see. This isn't just a one-off, fragile solution. This was developed on a global scale, combined in powerful ways to propel our business, but it was also done while we did a lot of custom work and a lot of ideation with our partners to build this out. We wanted to make sure we did it in a way that it could scale and that all our partners could take the benefits of this out into their businesses and scale it as well. We didn't want just a one-off proprietary solution just for us. We wanted to make sure more people could use the innovations from HP and Dell and Bloom and others in order to take that out, because that is what's going to grow the whole market and grow these innovations, make them more cost-effective. And so while we like being at that leading edge, we want to make sure it's something that can scale as well, and we're proud that we're able to do that. And you'll hear a lot more about that today. And so this really helps us not only with our goal to grow our business, but allows us to do it in a way where it's not at the expense of the environment, right? And so long term, we have a stated goal where we want to source at least 8% of our energy use from cleaner sources by the year 2015. And we feel like we're on a path to be able to do that with these kind of innovations that you're seeing here today. And so in addition to our partnership with Dell and HP, we've also committed to using cleaner and greener power here in Utah and around the world. And not only is this the first data center to do that live as its primary data source, but we'll also be announcing, and you're going to hear from Dean a little later this morning, another announcement that we'll be talking about that even takes us a step further in this whole end-to-end path of how we power the Bloom cells and how it powers the center. So I'll leave that news for Dean to talk about in a second. And as was mentioned earlier by Jim, as an interesting note, this would not have been made possible unless we had done the work with the regulators and the state here to help drive new legislations in Utah to help make all of this possible. And as you hear the whole story, it's quite compelling. But, you know, it was fascinating when I got the call from Dean that says, okay, I'm spending the day at the state capitol. It's like, you're the data center guy. Why aren't you in the data center? Well, we have to change the rules to make the data center better. And that's just part of the holistic approach that we've taken to do it, and you'll see. So with that, again, thank you. I'd like to introduce the next video that you'll be seeing to see how all this has come together. The video will highlight the work our partners have done. You'll see sort of how this was all built out. Again, it's thrilling to be here again from the groundbreaking just a year ago to I was here a few months ago and it was still wires and trucks everywhere, and then to come in and see and hear the cells all running and to know that it's all powering and to see the site running is phenomenal. So thanks again and enjoy the day. And now let's look at the video.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jonathan Kumi, Stanford University, and Dean Nelson, eBay Inc.
So welcome to the fireside chat. We have no fire, but that's
good.
Okay, because combustion is so 20th century anyway. So we're here to talk about a topic near and dear to my heart. I've been studying data centers since about the year 2000, and one of the things that's surprising to most folks who come to the data center industry anew is that making data centers efficient is not primarily a technical problem. Sure, there's lots of technology that goes into doing that, but ultimately, it's a problem of people and institutions, changing your organization to allow you to much more efficiently deliver the service that we want, which is the service of computing. And so we're here to talk about how that happened, mm-hmm. where the rubber meets the road. So Dean, I wanted to start by talking about organizational change. Clearly you made a lot of technical changes, but what were the organizational changes that you made to help those technical changes really take hold?
Sure, absolutely. And first off, welcome to our house. We're really glad you guys are here and sharing with us and collaborating with us. We wanted to share a little bit more information about this because I think it is really critical. The organizational alignment we have inside of eBay has enabled us to be able to be as innovative as we are and to drive it faster. So we report back up through Mark Karges. So Mark is the actual revenue side of the business. It is the technology that powers the engine that enables that $175 billion worth of commerce. So without that, it gets very difficult as you go down in the trenches to be able to make real change happen, because there's a lot of silos that usually happen. In a data center, it's the facilities team, and then there's the IT team, and usually they don't work together. There's a lot of this. The IT team comes in and says, I need to roll this rack in, and they say, well, what density is it? And then the facilities team says, that's too dense, I can't cool it. And so there's this disconnect. So by rolling all the teams together, you all are looking at the problem the same way. You all have the same goals, you have the same budgets, you have the same drivers, and you can really start to turn the knobs on efficiency.
Okay, what about language? You had a lot of work to do to make sure people were using the same terms for the same
sure.
concept. Can you talk a little bit about how that came about?
So translation, yeah. So we are speaking different languages. When we look at it, it's kilowatts, and then on the other side, it's bits and bytes, et cetera. So being able to help each side understand. And I tell you, in my past, I've been in a lot of technology-type roles, and then I went into real estate. And when I went into real estate, it was really eye-opening to me because they're trying to figure out exactly what the technical side needs and why they think like they do and what is it that's driving them. And so, and they were holding the purse strings in a lot of it, so that's where a lot of the conflict came up. When you start to translate TCO, and how do you calculate TCO, and you look at what it means to optimize the data center and optimize the hardware for that data center and the packaging, and then you start to do supply chain, everything comes together and gets extremely streamlined and very, very cost effective.
Right, so you said a key thing there, total cost of ownership. It comes back to dollars,
mm-hmm.
right? Not just the cost, but also the value being driven by
sure.
your IT. And so bringing it together in terms of dollars shows the importance of the business
mm-hmm.
to how you design the whole stack from the generators all the way up.
Absolutely. So the journey we've been on, I've been here around a little over 4 years now. And what I love is it's extremely clear who we're serving. We have 119 million active users on eBay.com. Those users need to be able to do their transactions. So everything from when they click on that phone and that goes back over a network and goes into a load balancer and points at a data center and runs into a front-end server that goes to a database, traverses that path, everything in there needs to be high performance, but it also needs to be cost-effective, and then it needs to be efficient around all of it. And so now that we have the ability to see that, the teams can start to understand what part they're delivering. And when you can now take the facilities team, the data center design, and say, this is why density is important. We have some of the densest racks out there, 40, 50 kilowatt capabilities. That's a huge amount of heat. And we package this up so that we can now get the ultimate efficiency. We're getting exceeding efficiencies out of these modules from Dell and HP outside. But it's only because we've been able to compact the hardware into the packaging and then optimize the infrastructure to power and cool it.
Okay, so typically in data centers, there are people who run the data center, who operate it, mm-hmm. who do the infrastructure, who do the IT, And the decisions to make the data center more efficient, typically the technical decisions, obviously, they're able to make, but the management decisions to make things really run more efficiently are above their pay grade. Mm-hmm. So how important was C-level buy-in, high-level management buy-in to making this all happen?
Yeah, we've had C-level buy-in because of that connection to the business for quite a while, and that org structure that made it just seamless. Right? We have to deliver infrastructure. This is the engine that powers the company. How do we ensure that we're going to be able to deliver the maximum performance with the most efficiency at the right cost, and like Mark said, not impact the planet with what we're doing? And so being able to, on part of this journey, we selected, we had about 80 to 100 different server configurations, different SKUs. And we consolidated those down to two, a high-performance compute SKU and a big data SKU. By simplifying all of that, we now started packaging these up in these racks, and then we set up a supply chain that allowed us to get them quickly. And then we were with our partners figuring the packaging of how they go into these modules. And then as we select our hardware, this is where TCO comes in. We take a server unit, we look at the actual unit cost, then we put the workload on it, the actual workload from eBay, and we see what the wattage is consumed in that device over a three-year period. So now I can take the total cost of that device in any of our centers and know exactly what it will be. And we choose our hardware based on the ultimate efficiency, the overall efficiency of that unit serving that traffic, not just the unit cost or the stated efficiency of the device.
Right, so it comes back to the business driver, the transactions
right.
related to your customers.
Absolutely.
Okay, so what about silos? How did you break down the silos within eBay? Because there were silos, right, when
yes,
you came?
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. And even though we were up through Mark, right, all the teams have been there. When my boss came in line, Sri Shivananda, he'll be talking next on the panel, it was great because he owned platform down when this all came together. So we had operations, right, engineering, but then you have the software on top, and it's so critical that those two components actually talk. Because a lot of times you can optimize everything underneath, and then the software just doesn't optimize to it, or the hardware is not optimized for the software. So bringing the platform team together, and the data team, and then the actual cloud team, and then foundation, which is the data centers, the network, and the hardware, suddenly make this one machine, and that machine can be fine-tuned. So we brought the teams in, and a simple thing like onboarding. So when we get a rack rolling in here, we need it to be ready and in our cloud as fast as possible. It was taking weeks to do those things, because that was just stages and manual processes. So the teams went back and addressed every step in there, and now we could actually bring it up in hours. So we roll it in here, it plugs in, it can actually be ready to serve traffic very quickly. That enables the business to actually keep up, right? We're driving the infrastructure to keep the business going as fast as possible.
Okay, and that speed also was enabled by having fewer SKUs, mm-hmm. right? Because you could have those things on the shelf.
Right.
You guys talk about the buffet style instead of having custom ordering.
Right,
each
right.
business unit can then come in and say, we need this much compute. Here are your standard devices to use
right.
to do that.
You know, and this is where terminology was important. So the translation between, so Debashish Saha runs our cloud team. And having that team understand what it means underneath for the physical environment, because the cloud is supposed to be virtual, but it has ties into the physical environment so that it can be virtual. And you need to know what those are. Once we got together and started looking at every step in the process, it just streamlined. And then the cloud team got it, and bam, they're developing the ways to go back and onboard faster. And then it just kept shrinking and shrinking that time. So we can deliver capacity into the cloud so that our developers can actually grab it very quickly and develop the features that go to our customers.
Okay. So Amory Lovins at Rocky Mountain Institute likes to talk about whole system integrated design. And he mm-hmm. says, if you optimize parts of the system, you're going to pessimize the whole system.
Sure.
It seems like you took that lesson to heart in how you designed this. Can you talk a little bit about how you think about the whole system and what kind of advantages that led to?
Right. Yeah, you know, as you saw in the video, we had all the modular construction. So we've been on a journey here learning quite a bit about how we can add capacity as we need it. So adding compute, but we need the data center to do the same thing. So Mike Lewis is my mission critical engineer, director of mission critical engineering. He designs and builds the data centers. And bringing him back together with the design teams and the tech teams and with his engineers and truly trying to figure out what in the data center designs should be different. So we started challenging the status quo, the assumptions. Almost every data center out there is built with generators and UPS. And a UPS is a great big battery pack, And a generator is, of course, an engine that lets you run continuously if you lose your utility feed. And we have a lot of instability in the U.S. grid when it comes to power. So every data center needs to make sure that it's up. But when we started looking at it going, that's been the design for the last 30 years. Generators and UPSs. They're used for less than 1% of the year. Only in failure situations or when you're testing to make sure they're going to operate when you fail. And that's usually when they fail, is when you need them the most. And so here we have this huge investment of tens of millions of dollars of major industrial-sized components. Is that really the best way to do it anymore? So that's when we started talking to Peter Gross over at Bloom. And I think it was your first day. He came in and he met with our CEO, with his CEO. And I was in New York at a conference and joined the call. And we were talking about what we could be doing with this new innovative technology. And luckily, we've had a partnership and been doing quite a bit with them before. But we said, maybe we can replace those components. And so afterwards, I went back and helped all my engineers, you know, get off the floor from that statement first, right? Mike was gracious enough to help me lift them up. But then we started thinking about it. And I challenged them, because we were right in the middle of starting this project. We said, we need to go back and make a decision. We've got a really efficient Gen UPS design, but is that the right way? So stop the engineering. Stop designing. Go off for the next 3 to 4 weeks and answer these questions. Technically, will it work? If we were to put fuel cells in here, would it replace the components of the Gens and UPS? Should we be doing that? Second, can we afford it? There's a big question, right?
Sure.
Everyone looks at it and goes, well, those are expensive units. So is the tens of millions of dollars I spend on these actual Gens and UPSs? Third was, we had a pretty aggressive schedule to deliver for the business. How can we make sure we're going to be able to meet them if we need to get a large capacity of fuel cells to it? So that journey, they came back after 4 weeks because our CEO, John, was saying, okay, great, tell me if this is something feasible. And they went back and said, you know, after looking into this a little deeper, this is a distributed system. The engineering of the box is actually more resilient. So it could give us more availability in it. It could actually have a better data center design. And so we went down the path a little further and heavy collaboration with Bloom. Everyone at Bloom was focused on how would this technology be applied to this new industry, because it's been in the real estate industry for a long time, right? Or going towards built real estate buildings. And we made the decision, announced it, took the leap of faith, but it was a confident leap of faith. First off, because we've got a solid engineering team, extremely solid partners that have built stuff with us that are open to the innovations and really will think through every bit of this, because that was critical. And then, of course, working with Bloom on the technology itself of how it's going to be integrated.
And you had operational data from your own experience of running the plant
right.
in the South Bay. So.
Yeah, so as we had that 500 kilowatt cell, that had a 3-year ROI, and it was generating power consistently, right? Great little units are just refrigerator-sized boxes sitting outside. So this journey of getting that decision, the fact that we could even do that, there's where the C-level buy-in was. We had a conversation with our CEO. Then we talked to Mark, right, about the technology. And we just kept going through the entire chain of saying, is this something we would want to do? And then the holistic view was, today we get our power from the grid in Utah. And it's not as clean as it could be. And it's difficult to get renewable sources inside of our renewable energy or cleaner energy. If we land these on the site, we're generating megawatts of power on site, and we're consuming it 100 feet away. That's extremely efficient. Then we're also using natural gas for those coming in, which is 49 to 50% cleaner than what we're getting from the grid. So when we say we're powering cleaner, greener commerce, the natural gas is cleaner than what we're getting. We're making steps ahead. And so that suddenly just made it very clear. We can kill a couple birds with one stone here. Yeah. And that is, we can increase the actual efficiency of the data center. We can actually lower the carbon footprint. And then we're going to be announcing a paper today as well from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And Andreas will be talking a little bit about it on the panel. But this is a paper that compares Bloom fuel cells in this installation to utility-fed data centers in the same location, two feeds or a single feed. And what we found in that thing was that this installation will be more available than those other two designs.
So cheaper, lower emissions, and more available.
Right. So just the bonuses that kept coming from challenging the status quo and taking a leap of faith on technology that you still felt really comfortable with because of the engineering talent and prowess behind it, and moving forward.
So that's the power of integrated whole system design.
Yeah, you're looking at the whole piece.
So there are a number of firsts at this installation. Can you tell us a little bit more about what those were?
Sure. So you saw that this is the first data center in the world with on-site primary power. And just to make sure that's clear, the natural gas going in the fuel cells converts to electricity that our computers consume directly. It is the power feed for the site. The utility that we have, the two feeds, are backup.
So does it feed DC power from the fuel cells directly to...
It doesn't. There's another efficiency.
Okay.
But it goes DC, and then we convert to 400-volt AC inside.
Okay.
But still very efficient, higher voltage on that side. So it's, again, the world's first data center with primary on-site power. So the next one is we've got the Dell EPIC. So that's the modular data center you've been seeing in the observation deck. It is the densest modular data center in the world. It's a megawatt. 24 cabinets at a megawatt. You can get 50 kilowatts per cabinet in here, all with free air cooling at 50 kilowatts. For those of you mechanical engineers that understand that part, it's really cool. It's really hot and really cool. But it's the world's densest modular data center deployment. And the next one is with HP. It's the HP EcoPod. It is the largest data center deployment, modular data center deployment. It's at 1.4 megawatts, 44 rack positions. You can see that right next to the Dell one. These modules are rack and roll capable. So let me explain that a little. We prepackage those standard SKUs that we get from Dell and HP in a rack. We can now roll that into a white space like here and plug it in, and our cloud takes over, and we can now roll it into the modular containers outside. That's a big deal because...
How fast can that be done? Like if you're compared to how you used to do.
So we have Serena DeVito that works on our staff. We have a 4,000-pound rack that she's able to actually maneuver into a container.
She's very strong, though.
She's Australian, so she's tough. But the point is that it's very simple to roll them in, and the innovation that that lines these racks up and allows them to go into position. But here we had our previous modules that were extremely efficient in Phoenix. There were 2,000 servers in a container, but you took the whole container away, when you were done. That means it had a life of 3 years. So you're paying for the data center shell and you're paying for the IT. This extends the life of the modules 3 times. So I can have this module be there for 3 tech refreshes, 9 years. So the unit cost goes down because I have this modularity. It's a simple thing. It's a physical thing, but that really is enabling us to now move the pieces around as we need. So those are 3 of the firsts.
Oh.
And can I say one
more? One more. Yes, please.
One more? All right. That's my quota. We are announcing a partnership with Ormat, and Ormat is a waste heat recovery technology. So they call it recovered energy generation. What you saw in the video was the fuel cells that are being powered with natural gas. Our original intent was to do biogas on top of that, because the natural gas has certain cleanliness, right? 49% cleaner than the grid, but you still have 49% of a carbon footprint. So we were looking for ways to go back and get biofuel that would remove the rest of the carbon footprint. And we would pay a premium for that power cost. What we ended up doing was we put a contract out trying to find people that could provide it. And there just isn't stable sources that are cost effective. And we started that having to go outside of Utah. And we thought, that doesn't make sense. We're going outside of our backyard. Why would we do that? So we used the legislation that was passed, we'll talk about in a minute, that allowed us to go back and ask for renewable sources. And we went out there, Ormat was one of the companies that came back from this RFI we put out. 20 companies responded, over 30 proposals. And they said, the natural gas feeding those fuel cells is 22 miles away. It's 1 mile away from the actual airport. But that's a compressor station. That compressor station, it's really high heat to keep moving the natural gas across all of Utah. If you capture the heat that's generated to pump that gas, it generates 5 megawatts of electricity. So we have 6 megawatts of electricity coming in from natural gas converted to electricity. Then 22 miles away, we're capturing waste heat and converting it to electricity, and it's coming back across the grid to us.
And that waste heat would not have been used.
It would have just gone into the atmosphere. It's 5 megawatts
of waste. Zero carbon, essentially. It's efficiency.
Yeah. So it's not officially renewable, but that's pretty clean, I got to say.
Okay, so you've also been moving towards super high density. So yeah. Describe the rationale for doing that, because not everyone is doing that in the data center industry, right?
Sure, sure.
Not to the level that you're doing it.
Yeah, we've found that optimizing the packaging. So let me step back. When we were looking at the performance of the hardware, so Jeremy Rodriguez runs the hardware engineering team for me, and we look at the actual performance on there as, you know, what kind of transactions you can get out of this device. Then you look at the wattage consumed by doing those transactions. Because a computer, when, you know, it's nighttime, Europe's on, you guys are asleep, and, you know, but there's still this cycle of load on all the equipment. But you need to look at what happens on that cycle, because it consumes more watts here and less watts here. It needs to be efficient at idle, and it needs to be efficient at mid, and it needs to be efficient at peak. So we started looking at the performance of that rack in terms of transactions it could do and the watts it would consume, and then the unit cost. Then that drove us to having denser packed racks was cheaper than having lower wattage servers spread out.
So cheaper per transaction.
Right. It's again that holistic view of what are we delivering? We're delivering search or buy and sell transactions to our customers outside. That translates into performance of the devices and then the infrastructure consumption to be able to deliver it.
Okay, so let's talk about software.
Okay.
Because based on the case study that Nicole Schutz and Anna Kovaleva and I did of your transition to efficiency, you guys had a huge push towards an internal cloud.
Mm-hmm.
And that had great efficiency. So describe first why you went that direction.
Sure.
And then what the benefits were.
So as you heard Mark talk, we've got the demand, right? It's coming in, and I swear the infrastructure has more than doubled since I've been here in 4 years. We've driven the efficiencies, right? But we keep increasing the demand. So when the teams were separate, right? When we had the cloud team and the infrastructure teams like this, it wasn't optimized. And when we consolidated the SKUs, we suddenly made it simpler for the software to be able to control the hardware. Can you imagine 100 different configurations you have to write code for to be able to communicate with so you can have the cloud work? We now have two. And suddenly the cloud would be able to deliver capacity fast. Our developers were taking weeks or months to be able to get resources. Like they would put in a ticket for compute and they'd have to wait for it. We'd have to order it, we'd have to install it, we'd have to bring it back up and then make sure it worked and give it to them. By standardizing this and decoupling the hardware, they just need compute units. So the cloud team is able to now present to them capacity. And that capacity is translated to all the infrastructure underneath. And they can get it like this.
So they just type in an account number.
Right.
In essence.
Yeah, it's an internal account
number.
But they can get the resources, and then we can watch and manage and optimize the demand that's coming from them, utilization, all those types of things. But the only way I believe the cloud would be successful is the partnership that we have of consolidating that and simplifying it, or else their jobs would be so incredibly complex to deal with that mixed environment underneath.
So we have
a really tight coupling between cloud and foundation.
Okay, so this abstraction from the physical characteristics turned out to be really important for increasing the agility of your IT organization.
Right, because in the past we had a lot of people would buy the hardware they wanted. It would just show up, right? And the data center guys have to figure out where it's going to go. Now we created a supply chain team that's under Richard Donaldson, and that forecasts what it is based on the standardized right configuration that now allows us to get it there just in time. So we're optimizing every step in that process so it's efficient as possible.
Okay. So when you talk about emissions from a data center, there's three big components. There's the efficiency of the infrastructure as measured in PUE typically. Mm-hmm. There's the efficiency of the IT equipment. And then there's the emissions intensity of the electricity that you're feeding to your data center. So can you describe for each of those three categories the innovations that you have put into this new facility?
Okay, and let me make sure I get them right. So say it again. It's the
infrastructure, IT efficiency, that would include utilization as well as other things, and then the electricity into the data center.
Right, okay. So, of course, what we're doing in the data center is optimizing for PUE. And for those that don't know what that is, most people do here, but it's power usage effectiveness. So think of the power coming to the building. Part of it goes to the computers to do the work, and the rest of it goes to the infrastructure to make the powers, the computers do the work. So the less infrastructure you consume, right, or power there, the more efficient your data center. So we've designed this facility to be a PUE of 1.2. That means for every watt of computer, it's only 0.2 watts of actual infrastructure.
Call it overhead.
Overhead to be able to do it. Losses in transformers, right? Cooling towers, et cetera. But that keeps driving down further and further. So that the facilities need to be able to have extreme efficiencies. And we've done this with density, right? So we've got 3-4 times the density of the majority of people out there, and we're still getting these kind of PUEs. And I'll tell you that what I love is every time we land a Dell or an HP container in our infrastructure, our PUE gets better because their PUEs are insanely efficient. It's 1.0 something, not 1.2. So it's almost like 96, 97% of the power is going to the computers to do work and not actually to the infrastructure for the waste.
So on the infrastructure side, we're on best new installations. We're pretty much dealt with that.
Yeah.
Right? We're almost done.
So the facility side is there. And we've optimized the design. And again, Mike's team has really driven how we can design these things for the efficiency there. Then we talked about the standardization of hardware and the IT, right? And that combined, how we design the hardware. And so we have a model right now that Dell and HP are extreme partners for us. They are an extension of our engineering team. They think for us. They understand our problems and come up with solutions that they can deliver to us in the packaging we have. Then we have the software teams, of course, the cloud teams and all that, that allow us to be able to optimize these pieces. So that element, facilities and then the hardware and software, right, come together. Now, the sourcing of power, this is where we've talked about we want to be able to get cleaner power. And we passed a bill last year, Senate Bill 12, that Mark was mentioning, that allowed us to be able to get that offsite power. In the past, this is a regulated utility environment. So if you're not a utility, you can't invest in something offsite. So we thought that was limiting. So we went to the governor's office, we pulled in the actual utility, we pulled in renewable providers, and we pulled our peers together and said, can we solve this problem? And what came out of that, led by Senator Mark Madsen, was Senate Bill 12, and it passed last year and enabled us to put this RFI out, and then we chose Ormat. So now we're sourcing clean energy, we're doing it on-site, and we're getting that renewable energy or really clean energy coming from Ormat off-site. That wouldn't have been possible without the bill itself.
Okay, so tell us a little bit more about that process that you went through. Like, who did you first approach?
To do it?
Change the law. Yeah, how did that
work? Well, see, like Mark was saying, I'm ignorant to the government relations part of it. So I just called people and said, hey, can we meet? And just pulled them into a room and just said, we got a problem, can we solve it? And that collaboration was great. And what those people were really looking for is, what is the problem we're trying to solve? We need 10 megawatts of power. How can we get it? There aren't options in the state. And so that now enabled us to invest a significant amount of money and to continue to expand in here. So the economic development that comes from enabling business to operate in places like this, right? Utah has been awesome, an awesome partner for us, and really enabled our business, whether it's the data centers or it's the customer support, right? The people in our real estate buildings here, we continue to grow. So.
Okay, so one more technical question on the servers. Some companies are designing custom servers.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm curious, I mean, I'm sure you specified certain unique features
sure.
for yours, but can you talk about how the servers that you spec'd
right.
relate to, you know, are they customized or are they,
yeah.
tell us about that.
So
as much as you can.
I do want to give a shout out because many of my peers are in the room here. What I love is the innovation that you guys are driving. We may have different paths. So, you know, going to an ODM versus an OEM, we have the same destination. That is to get the most efficient, cost-effective engine for our businesses, right? What we found in ours is that partnering with a Dell and HP and helping them understand and using them as an engineering right extension is really fine-tuned the infrastructure we're delivering. So that for our choices of hardware, they're ahead of the game. So everything we're developing, we're getting it first because it is custom hardware coming from these partners, but it's available for everyone else. So the modules you see outside, the actual compute units inside of it, are products that now have been developed to be consumed by the industry.
Got it. Okay, so let's turn for the last few minutes, we have about 6 minutes left, towards measurement.
Okay.
Because clearly you spend a lot of time thinking about how to measure
sure.
efficiency, how to measure success, how
right.
to... how to measure the important stuff related
yeah.
to the business. And that kind of culminates in the DSE unit.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about the process first of creating the DSE.
Okay.
And then also how you've been using it and how you anticipate using it
right.
to drive efficiency through the business.
Absolutely. So if we could bring up the DSC site. This morning we updated our site to a new dashboard. Let me explain what DSC is. So DSC is Digital Service Efficiency. And what that means is how efficiently we are delivering our services electronically to our customers. So think of those 119 million users. How do you measure the productivity of that engine? How do you measure the efficiency? And I'll tell you, I had a conversation with Alan Marks. He's our EVP of Communications. And he's a very straightforward guy. And he told me, he goes, you know, you guys are doing great things, but I don't get it. What does it mean to the business? You need to up-level the conversation. That was 3 years ago. And I remember it because I was frustrated walking out of that meeting going, why doesn't he get it, right? It's an engineering thing. It's simple. and he said, you need to be able to communicate what that value is, that business value. And that set us on a journey to come up with a miles per gallon measurement for infrastructure. So, and it's a difficult process, right, for us to go through. And so Jeremy and I jumped into this on the hardware engineering side, and then Serena joined, and we started getting a lot of people in to analyze it. What we found was there are four dimensions that our executives care about. It's performance, cost, environmental impact, and revenue. Those are the four KPIs that they look at. So how do we translate those back into the infrastructure and designs and operations that we're doing underneath? So we needed to have a numerator and a denominator. So the numerator is the hardest thing for any business out there to find. It's the work that's done. So we finally found a common currency. And the currency was, our transaction is a URL request. When you pull out your phone and you do a search for something, you're looking for it, you're generating these URL requests into the infrastructure. So those front-end customer requests, last year we did 4.3 trillion of them. Okay, there's a lot of requests that come. But behind that, it's orders of magnitude bigger. So the infrastructure behind it to deliver it. So those transactions were the numerator, and then it was the denominator was the kilowatt hours consumed to do it. In your house, you get a bill every month with kilowatt hours consumed, and you pay a cost per kilowatt hour. Great. Now if we have the transactions per kilowatt hour or URLs per kilowatt hour, we've got performance. But like a Rubik's Cube, we needed to be able to have the other sides. We now needed to do cost per transaction or URL. Then I could look at environmental impact or CO2 per URL. And ultimately, I could look at revenue per URL. It suddenly made the ecosystem that is this infrastructure and the business visibility into it clear. So I walked back into Mark's office before we announced this outside, and I said, thank you for pushing me so hard.
But how long did it take?
It took 3 years.
3 years?
It took 3 years okay. to go really think through it, because we have intense data that we collect on the transactions on our site. And trying to just analyze that data and come up with a simple way that you can measure it was there. So if you go to tech.ebay.com, the new site has DSC on it, and in there you will see a dashboard that shows performance, cost, environmental impact, and revenue per unit of measure for the last 6 quarters. So we had 2012 baseline, and then we've done year-over-year comparisons in Q1 and in Q2. And the reason we're doing, and here's the dashboard, the reason we're doing this is that we found something that's been very effective for our business, and it helps us drive decisions. One of those was, Sri made a choice in Q1, and he said, okay, we have 52,000 servers, you can see down here. Stop buying servers for a quarter. Stop buying servers. That's a big deal. We stopped buying servers for a quarter, and all of a sudden everyone was figuring out how to increase the utilization. And it changed every number on that actual graph. What you measure, you can do something about. And it gave visibility to now start figuring out what big knobs do we turn. So if you notice on the bottom, we can do, it's the energy sourcing, then it's the efficiency of the data center, and then it's the infrastructure itself. We have 119 million people with 52,000 servers consuming or demanding 20 megawatts of power at any given time. This is our entire infrastructure, and then the business KPIs on the right of revenue, cost, and environmental impact. So.
Okay, so what about costs within the organization? Mm-hmm. I know you haven't yet implemented chargeback
sure.
to the business units, but what about using these kind of metrics to influence the
right.
business units?
If you look at it, this is a top-level measurement, and what we want to be able to do is look back on the quarter of how it did, but ultimately what we want to be able to do is drive the programs and measure the effectiveness of those programs at the end of the quarter. And so now you have a whole bunch of programs underneath it that you would do that move the needle of the actual DSC metric. And so that's where we're trying to get people to understand the larger business implications of the designs they do. So it's the data center designs that they're trying to have lower PUE. That means we have less kilowatt hours for the transactions. Then you've got the hardware designs. The more work we get done in that with the less watts we consumed is more work that's done. And then on top of that, the software guys, they're figuring out how to optimize the software to be able to drive the optimum performance underneath. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so it's all the way up the stack. It's not just physical, it's all the way up through delivery of business value to customers.
Yes, and that was the connection. Connect the C-suite to the significant investments you make in infrastructure. It doesn't matter what design, what partner, what solution, whatever, it's the result of those design decisions and operations decisions. That's the metric. What the metric shows. Because every business is a little different. But when you measure this, you can see how effective or how much productivity is coming out of that engine. It's the miles per gallon for technical infrastructure.
Great. So we're just about out of time. I just wanted to put in a plug for the case study.
Yes. Can I put a plug in for it?
Please. Why don't you do it?
All right. So John is just a brainiac. He's at Stanford. Sorry. It's a good term. He's an uber geek. It's a compliment. John and two of his MBA students and
Nicole Schutz is there.
Yep. They came in and spent probably a few months with us and interviewed us and said, you know, we would like to write about what you guys have done. And so you published
from a
this
management
paper.
Perspective, not yes. technical, management perspective.
Yes, and so this paper is available today. And so authored by the three of you, and I really appreciate you guys spending the time doing that.
Yeah, thank you. And it's up on I'm affiliated with the Steyer Taylor Center for Energy Policy and Finance at Stanford. It's up on their site right now. It's also up on eBay somewhere?
Yes, it's up on tech.ebay.com.
Okay.
So, all the papers and, of course, this
So event. Freely downloadable. If you're interested in how to change your management and organizational structure to have a more efficient data center, it's a good place to learn.
Yes, absolutely. And, of course, there is the University of Illinois Champaign, Urbana-Champaign paper comparing the on-site versus off-site generation. That's up on the same site. Great.
So great.
Well, thank you very much, John.
My pleasure.
Awesome.
We're very fortunate to have two executives who are responsible for developing this facility, an academic, an engineer who is responsible for measuring its overall effectiveness, and one of the policymakers here in Utah who helped make it happen. To my immediate left is Sri Srinivanda, the Vice President of Platform and Infrastructure at eBay, Inc. To his left is Peter Gross, VP Mission Critical Systems at Bloom Energy. To his left is Andreas Kangalares, the Dean of the College of Engineering at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, and then finally Jeff Barrett, the Director of Policy and Incentives, the Utah Governor's Office of Energy Development. Sri, I'd like to start with you. What were some of the business imperatives that drove this very, very big leap for eBay?
Let me cover that with about four or five points that I have. Number one was actually scale. So online commerce is actually now growing all across the globe. It's entering newer and newer countries. And then mobile is now connecting people to things that they always wanted, anywhere, anytime, right? And what this is doing is we did about $175 billion of commerce volume last year. And we expect that over the next few years for us, it actually will grow into $300 billion. So scale is not so much an option. I mean, more and more shopping is moving online. And as we do this, we have to make sure that the infrastructure stays on par with those demands coming from business. So it was about scaling to the business and making sure the business never feels a lack of infrastructure. Second, you heard some of the metrics today about the number of users we have on the site. Availability is a big thing for us. So we have 120 million shoppers on eBay. And we have 25 million sellers. Now, a critical component of that is, of that 25 million sellers, a little over a million of them actually make their primary living on eBay. So it's an obligation for us to create great experiences for our shoppers, but there is a human commitment we have to those sellers to make sure that their livelihood is not impacted, right? So we have to be a 24/7, 365 shop. We cannot be down for a second. And we need to make sure that our infrastructure is reliable and can actually support that need as well. Third, I would say, was about looking and creating opportunities, creating possibilities. So when we started this journey, we didn't have a lot of choices in terms of alternate power. So we looked at the ecosystem. We looked for other people who had the same mission. And we brought them in. We had that conversation. What we wanted to do was not just get to cleaner, greener commerce, but we also wanted to take the next step in terms of changing the data center space in terms of what we wanted with modularity, what we wanted with density, what we wanted with choices in cooling, and in electricity for that matter. And finally, it was just about innovating and taking data centers to the next level. So all of this together and the agility that the business needed. So we can't always anticipate the demand that the business has. We need to build infrastructure ahead of that and build it in a way that we don't make all of those investments in one big shot. We can make it in a way that we can go stepwise over a period of time. This is where this data center breaks ground in creating that capability for eBay Inc.
And Peter, why Bloom?
Well, yeah, good question. listening to Mark and to Sri and to Dean, what eBay has been looking for, and for that matter, pretty much any data center operator who's looking for the same things. It's reliability, it's total cost of ownership, it's energy efficiency, and one can make the case that energy efficiency is part of the total cost of ownership. It's green, it's sustainability and carbon footprint, it's scalability, it's modularity, it's agility, and it's right provisioning. I mean, this is what eBay wants, this is what a lot of other people want. In the traditional architecture, these are essentially divergent requirements. Obviously, the more reliable a system is, the higher the level of redundancy, the higher the cost, the lower the energy efficiency, the higher the carbon footprint. All these things are very closely interrelated. So how do you bring convergence? How do you bring all these requirements together in a system that has the ability to bring them to optimize them? It's a matter of vision. I think Dean mentioned leap of faith. This is what eBay did. You know, this industry, as you very well know, it's very conservative, but innovation comes very, very slowly here. Not much had changed in 30 years. I think Dean mentioned that. Not much changed in 30 years, but what eBay did here to really take a very strong thought leadership, analyzing the benefits and the risk associated with the solution like this, and bringing it all together and building this truly revolutionary, disruptive, transformational data center that, in my opinion, will have a major, major impact on our industry and how the data centers will be built in the future.
And so you're responsible, Andreas, for measuring the impact. let's start with the basics. What does this mean for this facility and for eBay Inc.?
So let me repeat that what we see here is a significant departure from the past. We see a bold move to provide energy directly from the Bloom boxes right on site. With two utility feeders as backup. Just think about it. Right away, you have the tripled redundancy that one encounters in mission-critical systems that the aeronautical industry is very useful to, mm-hmm. very used to. But this is something that this industry wants. We heard 24/7. We want no interruptions. We need to meet demand that is very high. You need to have that availability and that reliability that makes all the difference for your customer. And providing that in a way that is both a very low carbon footprint and more efficient is very important. What we see here is the study at Illinois was really driven by experts in power and energy systems. They looked at the three systems that were provided to us, the new implementation of Quicksilver and the other two, And the results were very, very impressive in terms of reliability, 10 times more reliable the system than the other two. In terms of energy efficiency, 23% more efficient than the others. And as far as carbon emissions go, CO2 emissions, 49% less in this system.
And taking a bigger look, what could these improvements essentially potentially mean for the industry as a whole?
Look, if I am not mistaken, I think about 2% of all the energy that the United States of America consumes annually is being consumed by data centers. Mm-hmm. If you do the numbers, my estimate will give you a little more than 1 megawatt hour per year for each one of us, just for us to enjoy our life in cyberspace. And that is a number that will keep increasing.
I'm sorry, I heard a few people make noise in the audience. Is that
the number.
It is quite
impressive. And I mean, we look at that number and we realize right away that it's a responsibility for us to make everybody much more aware of the fact that there is an energy price tag associated with our cyberspace experience. And that will increase. If you think about e-commerce, it's exploding. New applications that are data intensive. Think about health IT. Think about smart infrastructure. All of these things that everybody wants and relies upon demand significant access to data management, data processing. And so I look at that and I tell myself, what eBay is doing here is giving us an example of what will need to happen beyond just technological innovation for us to be able to meet this very high energy demand that these new markets provide us with. And it is this very bold leadership, these very creative partnerships that require a very broad, educated public to make this possible. So at the University of Illinois, one of the things we are committed to is what we call, think of it as energy in the environment initiative in our educational mission and our research enterprise. What this really means is looking at this young generation, to them, you know, talking about cleaner and greener energy is not just an expectation, it's a way of life. And these are the customers of the future that will demand much more from the services they expect. So we're trying to make sure that this attitude that energy efficiency, clean energy, green energy is possible is something that everybody expects, and the industry better become much more creative, much more bold in making the partnerships that are needed to support this tremendous future.
And a big part of that is probably the new terms of art, the metrics, the creative use of numerators and denominators to be a much easier way to communicate with your peers, with your strategic partners, with policymakers. Is there anything from the report that talks a little bit about the potential for taking those metrics to a broader level?
The report is trying to be as scientific as possible about the assessment. We want to have what we call a very frank consideration of the options that are there. But I believe one of the things we see is that on-site energy provided by Bloombox technology or other renewables, if possible, is something that will continue to penetrate in the market, provided, of course, that the real partnerships are being formed.
That's great. Now, there are a number of partners in the state of Utah that made this possible, at the governor's office and the legislature. Jeff, first, what do you think this could potentially mean for the state, this development?
Well, it means a lot for the state. I mean, we're fortunate to have a lot of great partners in business coming to the state of Utah right now. And, you know, for the state of Utah, this means 1,500 plus jobs. I think actually a few hundred more than that. You know, Salt Lake City is about 190,000. So 1,000 jobs may not be that much to a New Yorker or a Californian, but in Utah, 1,000 jobs is a big number. 1,500 is even bigger. There are only a handful of corporations, businesses that show us those kind of numbers. And so we really appreciate that. You know, Utah is doing really well right now, business-wise, and this speaks to it. I mean, we've been on the cover of Forbes magazine as the best state for business in America 3 years in a row, 11, 12, 13. And there are a number of reasons for that. We have low energy costs. We have a young and really talented workforce. I mean, we're the youngest state in the nation by a long shot. Texas is number two, I believe. There's some Houstoners here.
You got to be careful.
Probably a lot.
Yeah.
So there's the workforce, there's the energy. What else? You know, there's the quality of life. Mm-hmm. I mean, we just got our first inch of snow in the mountains last night. There are 500 more coming. So it's, yeah, talk to me, all of you. So it's a great place to live, and so, you know, people are starting to realize that. And so it's this combination of factors that you know, is, I think, reflected in a business like you, like eBay, that's really ahead of the game coming here. It's also the fact that the government's willing to partner. And so, you know, with eBay, in the past 2 years, we've worked with them on the Senate Bill 12 legislation that we've been talking about on and off throughout the morning. That allows them, companies like eBay, to partner directly with energy companies to bring power of their choosing to their facilities. That's huge. We worked with them on tax exemptions. We worked with them on deployment of solar photovoltaic panels on their facilities. So that's just one state office. And so it's really important that we continue to interact with businesses like eBay to kind of drive the state forward in terms of economic development.
Well, and you say continue to work with, because you know, one could think that having accomplished what you've accomplished today, then things are done. But the beauty of a facility like this is there's momentum to it. You know, when you bring in new talented engineers and give them the freedom to come up with new solutions that they can't do in other places, you're going to attract more scientists, more applications, and so likely you're going to be busy.
That's right. And the Utah Technology Council right now has this new initiative called Silicon Slopes, where we're really, you know, the aim is to be for the tech sector. We're starting with data centers, but we're going to colonize, of course, to be to the tech sector sort of a new Silicon Valley, but with better skiing. So keep track of us, folks, because we thank you all, and we're really excited. We're really excited about eBay being part of the momentum and really seeing this part of the valley and then throughout the state economic development pick up in this area.
And we have representatives from the entire Utah congressional delegation in this office. So if you see someone to your left who is disregarding the rule about turning off their phones and they're checking to see whether their job is going to be shut down next week, it's probably someone from one of the members of Congress representing this great state. So just nudge them or something. Well, so the whole point of this is to try to give the peers who are here some information, some advice about, you know, what you learned along the way. So, Shri, we'll start with you. For companies considering something like this, what are the essential ingredients?
I would say the most important thing is the vision, right? I mean, it starts with that vision. It starts with that clarity of thought, something that will take you through the future. It'll future-proof your investments. It's about challenging the status quo, looking at things that will still be relevant a decade from now, not something that's already 30 years old, right? And that vision has to be strong, something that is good enough that you can articulate and rally people, not just within the company, but in the whole ecosystem, the partners that you have, the vendors, the state, and so on. That's the most critical thing. I think it's the vision. Second is its leadership at all levels. Something like this needs courage. Our CTO, Mark, and then John, our CEO, both supporting something like this, which is a big investment and a big risk. And then the leadership of Dean and his team to basically, for Star Trek fans here, take a data center where no data center has ever gone before, right? That's huge. It's about challenging status quo, asking hard questions, making tough choices, taking relevant risks where necessary, and making sure everybody is participating. Third thing I would say is collaboration and partnership. I think it's not just collaboration and partnership within teams within the eBay Inc. family, but it's also with all our vendors and then with the state. I mean, everything that we have accomplished here is actually the power of that whole ecosystem. Right? It's not just eBay. It's eBay, it's HP, Dell, every other vendor that has worked with us in the design of the data center itself, and then the state of Utah. I mean, we've talked about SB 12 so much. A big part of getting this started and the foundation for it was the passing of SB 12, which allowed us the capability, companies like us, to actually buy power from renewable sources directly and not having to go through utility providers, right? So all of this has been extremely critical. It is vision. It's articulating that vision and creating a strong purpose around it. It's leadership, which is courage to actually do something of this nature in terms of investment and risk and going forward with it. And then it's the ecosystem of partners, the collaboration with them, and going through and delivering on that shared purpose and mission that we created together in the span of a year. I mean, that's huge.
That's great.
Yeah.
Now, Peter, you made a comment earlier about there are some companies that really believe in making the tough choices that real innovation requires, and that there are a lot of companies that use a lot of technology, but they tend to be more conservative. Can you walk us through that a little bit?
Sure. As I said before, tough business, very conservative. What I like to say is that in this business, in our industry, data center industry, everybody loves innovation as long as that solution or piece of equipment has been operational for 20 years. It's sad, but that's the reality. Things have changed the last few years, and the advent of hyperscale, the vision and innovation of companies like Google and Facebook, Apple, Yahoo, and certainly eBay have changed the trajectory of this industry. And the best example is this project. On the cooling side, mechanical side, innovation has been coming a little bit easier for a variety of reasons. On the electrical side, I've been in this business for a long, long time. Long time, since early 1800s. nothing has changed. I mean, essentially, and Dean mentioned that, the same architecture has been prevalent in this industry forever. This is the first time that someone looks at the components of the system and asks some tough questions. Why do we need to have all these systems that don't do anything? They consume energy, they consume a lot of resources, they require a lot of care, and we hope that we'll never use them because that's when they fail. I mean, an analogy is, why would people spend all this money and hope that they'll never use it? I think life insurance is the only thing that mirrors this. And you always need the life insurance. You're going to use it eventually. But here, maybe you'll never use the UPS or the generator, whatever. So this is a first step, in my opinion, on a very dramatic journey that will totally change this industry, and I think I have to think that that eBay and their thought leadership, their vision, their alignment in scope, in goals, and objectives will pave the way for the next generation data center.
Now, are there any specific changes or challenges with the technology that either of you think are worth pointing out to the audience? Anything that you didn't expect that happened? And then I'd like to follow up, because I know the results from the study were better than people expected. So what were there any specific examples of challenges that you had to overcome that other people might face that and not expect it? Sri?
I'd say that when you embark on a journey of this nature where things are unknown completely, you have risk at every single step, right? And I think working as a team and collaborating across all of these ecosystem partners, we have discovered a lot through that, but nothing that was technically not possible to overcome, right? I think the industry has evolved to a place where innovation, there's so much innovation happening that when people put their mind to it, they can bypass anything that comes in the way. So we've had challenges for sure, but like I think together as a team, the team has been able to get through each one of them. Mm-hmm. And of course, we're just getting the operation started.
Right.
So the learning journey actually has just begun. Mm-hmm. There's a lot more we'll learn through the life cycle of what we have put here.
Right.
But our confidence is that, one, it's definitely a viable alternative to what has happened in the past, and it's the confidence that each one of these technologies, every one of them, whether it's the electricity, the heat regeneration through RMAT, or what we're doing with those modular data centers, is all going to evolve.
Right.
We ourselves have seen the evolution of modular data centers. I think we are on to our second, third generation modular data centers at this point in time. We have seven of these up on the roof in the Phoenix data center. Everything from, I think the first one of those is actually coming up for a tech refresh like this year. And when we do that, what will we do? We'll actually take stock of everything that's happened with it, all the failure modes and so on. And it's a continuous process of exchange between us, Dell, and HP to say, okay, what do we do better in the next one? This is how the innovation around rack and roll within a modular container actually came up. We said, like, let's challenge that and say, like, why do we need to take the container away
mm-hmm.
when three years is done or 4 years is done? We said, okay, let's actually take that agility that we get from rack and roll within the white space and push it into these containers as well. So we extend the life of the containers. So I would summarize it as, like, there have been many learnings through the process,
mm-hmm.
some positive surprises as well,
right.
in terms of reliability and what we see with what we put there. But the biggest thing of all, I think, is the fact that we see us achieving our goals in being able to do a stepwise increase in the investment in the data center, not having to go build everything up front. We can now go 2,000 servers at a time,
right?
Or 44 racks at a time if it's the eco part, right?
So that's the demand side. What about Peter on the supply side?
You know, innovation is hard. Life is complicated enough. Engineers and management, for that matter, would much rather, in many cases, much rather do the same thing over and over. You know, why complicate my life? Why try something when the outcome is questionable? There is always risk. There is always, but if companies like eBay would not take this leap and look at the future, go deep into the analysis of the technology, of the benefits, of the risk, of the process, will never advance in this industry. And you know, there are many lessons we learn together here. It's all about collaboration. It's all about ability to learn together, ability to be flexible enough. There is nothing more important than matching the vision with the execution. And here we had both. We had with Sri and Dean with their vision and setting up the goals and the objectives. And then we had an extremely competent engineering staff. And I cannot say enough about Mike Lewis and James Monahan and many others that were able to really transform this idea, this concept into a tangible product and something that works. And the fact that all the other partners here, the engineer and the construction and the testing outfit, all these people working together in a collaborative way have made this project a success.
And so, Andreas, going back to the study, what were the surprises for you when you completed the work?
So we were very impressed with the reliability. And it all became clear when we started looking into the Bloom Energy boxes. They made a big difference. And Peter does not really give Bloom Energy enough credit. They really put together technology that is highly reliable, and being on site makes a big difference. He can give you more details if you want about what makes that reliability happen by the box, but it was very impressive to us to see it in action.
That's great. Well, we have breakouts that will be coming up after lunch, and we'll be able to do a deep dive on that. We only got a little bit of time left. Sri, any final comments for the group?
I would say I'd love for the industry, our peers, to take this as one step towards building momentum in how we do data center design and how we actually measure true efficiency of infrastructure. And you heard a little bit about DSE today. And DSE is an attempt to say measuring the efficiency down just at the PUE level in the data center is not sufficient. You have to go up the stack. It's about business value and the cost that it takes to deliver that business value and the whole ecosystem. The metric that we've come up with is an attempt for us to internally communicate to every level of engineer, whether it's a person in the data center, a person in the cloud engineering team, a hardware engineer, a software engineer building front end. It's to communicate with all of them how they can actually make a contribution in making this engine more efficient. In doing so, what we've tried to do is we've tried to create transparency. We're talking about this. And the interest there is that we actually start a dialogue. And that dialogue then can lead to a whole lot more collaboration, more than what we've even seen. We've seen the power of collaboration on this between the state, academia, the vendor ecosystem, and businesses like us. And imagine what happens if more businesses were to join this. I think we can create a step function change in how we do data center design, how we measure efficiency. That's something that I'm actually truly looking forward to.
Terrific. Well, thank you all very much for joining us. We really appreciate it. And we will be having a few more closing remarks, and then we'll be going to lunch, and then we'll have the breakouts after.
Great.
Thank you very
Thanks,
much.
Sir.
So as I mentioned earlier, Business Forward has been working with eBay for a long time, and we work with business leaders all around the country, tens of thousands. We've done briefings on pretty much every topic you can, and we've worked with more than 400 mayors, members, governors, senior administration officials. And I want, just to, in closing, to give you a sense of why this group is so different from most of the other briefings we do, and sort of keying off of Sri's call to action. There are very few companies in the world with the capacity to tackle big problems the way eBay has. You've got the brain power, you've got the budgets, you've got the business imperative, and there aren't that many companies out there like you. Even if they've got as big a budget as yours, what we've found in our experience dealing with tens of thousands of business leaders is there isn't that culture of innovation. What we see when we work with companies like eBay or the peers in the group like Apple and Facebook is when you come into being by disrupting your industry, there's just a culture that goes and tries to disrupt every element of your business. And the hunger that you guys see, you know, in your offices is really, really rare. And for some of the companies that are innovators like you are, there's this other thing. And it's something that's really struck me in talking with eBay executives for the last 2 days. And that's this sense of higher purpose. The idea that we're not just going to go through and innovate every business action we take or every cost center we have for the purpose of lowering costs and increasing shareholder value. There's this sense among the eBay executives that have been here today that, you know, we have a higher job to do, and we really can have a big impact on the planet. You are enormously powerful. You're enormously busy people. If there's anything that we can do to make it easier for you to get your questions answered, or if you've got feedback for the team, just let us know. We're here to make your time here as efficient as possible, because the bottom line is very clear. If you guys don't get together to do this, no one else can. And so with that in mind, I'd like to bring up Dean again, who will talk a little bit more about the rest of the program. So thank you.
Excellent. So I'm just going to be saying thank you to a couple people here. First, for all of you spending the time, this is valuable time. Coming out to Utah, seeing what we're doing. So this is the employees, this is the partners, these are our government officials, right? All of the different people here that have helped us make this event possible. And we've got quite a few partners that have helped us actually be successful over the last 18 months. And you can see them behind me. I can't thank you enough for the innovation and your commitment to doing these projects. Without your drive, we would not have the resources and the ability to execute on the things that we really want to accomplish. So thank you very much. You can see these partners. All of them are outside. Talk to them. See what they're innovating on. Lastly, there are some people in this project that have done some substantial work. I'm going to miss a whole bunch of names, but there's just a few I want to call out. Mike Lewis, thank you for your leadership in the design. Mike has an engineer on his team called James Monahan, who is a rock star, and he has spent countless hours. And James, you've done countless hours working with the Bloom team, making the Bloom fuel cells actually function for the first time as primary power for a data center. Sean Tugwell, the beauty you see in these data centers is all his baby. Jeremy Rodriguez, the hardware engineering, the modules have been put outside with Dell and HP, the incredible hours and innovation that have gone into those things. There are hundreds more of people that have done incredible work in this, and we don't have time to go through them all, but thank you, all of you, for the work that you've done. The last thing, we really want a call to action. That call to action is that you should be challenging the status quo. What else should we be doing differently? What else should we be thinking about for our business to power cleaner and greener commerce? That whole story. What about for your business? What are those key drivers? What are those business imperatives? And how would you build the things underneath there to change the game? This is the collaboration that we're going to be talking about this afternoon with my peers and all of our partners. What else can we do to move this industry forward? So thank you very much for attending. Enjoy the rest of the day.